Good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you're tuning into. Welcome to Website Compliance under the Americans with Disabilities Act. My name is Megan Quinn, and I am here with
David Gavert.
And we're happy to get started, but first, we have a few housekeeping notes. There's a Q&A box. Please submit your questions there, and we'll hopefully get to them at the end of the presentation. Also, we would appreciate your feedback at the end of the webinar. You can expect a PDF presentation to be sent out, emailed out over the next few days, and you are free to connect with us either through Twitter or LinkedIn or through our website. All right, now that we've covered those basics, we can go through our roadmap. I will first discuss the basics of the ADA to make sure everyone has a good foundation. I will then discuss whether or not the ADA applies to websites. David will then take over and he'll cover the WCAG guidelines and identify risks and how to reduce those risks regarding ADA website compliance. All right, so first thing. The Americans with Disabilities Act, also known as the ADA, prohibits discrimination against people with disabilities. It covers a wide range of spheres, including Title I, which applies to private employers, and Title III, which applies to private entities that operate places of public accommodation. The Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, which is the EEOC, enforces and regulates Title I of the ADA, and the DOJ enforces Title III. The ADA was enacted in 1990 under President Clinton, and like I said, it's wide-ranging. Later in the presentation, David will discuss how ADA website compliance affects employers, which would be Title I, but the majority of this presentation will discuss Title III, which is websites operated by places of public accommodation. Title III states that no individual shall be discriminated against on the basis of disability in the full and equal enjoyment of the goods, services, facilities, privileges, advantages, or accommodations of any place of public accommodation. All right. In order to fall under the protected class of the ADA, a person must be disabled. The statute defines disability as a physical or mental impairment that substantially limits one or more major life activities of such individual. Major life activity is defined very broadly. It includes but is not limited to walking, standing, lifting, operations of major bodily functions such as normal cell growth, brain, respiratory functions, and a determination of whether a major life activity is impaired is done without regard to any mitigating measures such as assistive technology and medication. Substantially limited is also broadly construed, and it's an individual assessment which requires determine whether a condition substantially limits a major life activity. The bottom line here is that this is a low bar. There are certain conditions that are almost always considered to be a disability under the ADA. Those include bipolar disorder, cancer, epilepsy. There are also characteristics that are expressly excluded from the disability definition. Those include the current use of illegal drugs, homosexuality, compulsive gambling, and kleptomania. In order to fall under the ADA, Title III specifically, a place of a public accommodation must affect interstate commerce. This is not going to be a bar for most places, particularly in our very interconnected world. Most businesses are doing business interstate. You know, you have customers from more than your state. You're putting goods and services into the general stream of commerce So most businesses are going to fall under affecting interstate commerce. The more interesting thing is the definition, or rather lack of definition, of a place of public accommodation. Instead of providing a concrete definition, the statute provides a list, but not all-inclusive list, of examples of places of public accommodation. So just to rattle off a few, they include inns, restaurants, motion picture houses, auditoriums, bakeries, laundromats. Arguably, all of these are physical locations, although, as we will discuss later, there is some argument that places that are named, such as travel services and shoe repair services, or places service establishments, are not actual physical locations. The basic elements of an ADA claim that you will see under Title III are that a plaintiff will allege that he or she is disabled. As I just discussed, disability is broadly defined, so therefore this will usually be a given. Oftentimes we see someone who is has a physical disability that prevents them from getting around easily, or as will pertain to kind of website complaints, you know, someone who has a hearing or eyesight disability. The defendant will be responsible for a place of public accommodation, as we just discussed. There will be some kind of discriminatory action that plaintiff will not be able to access something, whether that's not being able to get into a restaurant or get to the counter, or if website complaints, you'll see someone cannot access fully the website. And then the person will allege that that discriminatory action was caused by the plaintiff's disability. So they could not access your website because it's not set up to work with their screen reader, and that is related to their eyesight disability. All right, so now that we've covered kind of the basics of the ADA and made sure that everyone has a good foundation of understanding, we can jump into the heart of this presentation. And the first part, the first question is whether a website constitutes a place of public accommodation under the ADA. When answering questions like this, the first place we look to is the statute, the law itself, and the wording there. Unfortunately, in this case, the statute is silent. As I said, the definition for place of public accommodation is a list of examples. It neither expressly limits a place of public accommodation to physical locations, nor does it expressly include non-physical locations. The policy language is very broad, and people and courts will look to that policy language to argue that websites should be considered places of public accommodation. However, on the flip side, the legislative history of the statute shows that there was a catch-all on that place of public accommodation definition that said, and other similar places, and that this was removed before the final version of the law was enacted, which defendants and other parties will argue that this means that websites should be excluded from the definition. One thing to note is that the statute was enacted in 1990, so well before the internet was used in the way that it presently is, and certainly maybe well before people contemplated the true use of the internet. And therefore, it's just simply possible that the statute has not caught up to the current state of technology. The next place to look for when answering this question is to the courts. And once again, it's unclear. There isn't a Supreme Court case that has tackled this issue directly. and the courts of appeal and the district courts within those circuits are split. So you have certain circuits of appeal that have not addressed the issue at all, and then you have other ones that say that a place of public accommodation can be independent of a physical location, and then other ones that say that there must be a sufficient nexus between a physical location and a website in order to be a place of public accommodation. So the first relevant case actually does not have anything to do with a website. Instead, it was an association of hearing impaired individuals who alleged that the NFL and the member clubs, meaning the specific teams, and the media had discriminated against them with the NFL blackout rule. And the NFL blackout rule prohibits live local broadcast of home games that have not sold out within 72 hours before game time. The defendants successfully argued that they were not places of public accommodation because, while the games happened at a physical location, the NFL itself and the team members and the media were not places of public accommodation. However, in this case, National Federation of the Blind versus Target Corporation, the court differentiated between information services unconnected to physical target locations and goods and services that were offered by the Target stores. So this was plaintiffs alleging that Target.com, so Target's website, impeded their ability to enjoy the full and equal enjoyment of the goods and services offered in Target stores. So the court said that information and services that were not connected to the physical Target stores was not covered by the ADA, but that any services and goods offered by Target stores was covered by the ADA. In contrast, and this is a case that, again, doesn't have to do with websites, but has been relied upon by later cases regarding websites. In contrast, car parts distribution versus auto wholesalers. Now, this is a plaintiff who died of AIDS. He was the sole shareholder of Car Parts, which was an automotive wholesaler distributor. And Car Parts was part of a medical reimbursement plan, and the plaintiff and Car Parts on his behalf had submitted claims regarding his illness. At some point, after the plan became aware of the plaintiff's illness, the plan placed a cap on AIDS-related expenses. And plaintiffs alleged this cap was ADA discrimination. And the defendants, in turn, argued that they were not a place of public accommodation because they were simply a medical reimbursement plan. And the district court dismissed the case based on the defendant's argument, and the plaintiffs appealed. And the court sided with the plaintiffs that they did not need to be a place of public accommodation. It said that neither Title III nor its regulations make any mention of physical boundaries or physical entry, and observed that many goods and services are sold over the phone or through mail without a customer ever entering a physical location. It simply reasoned that to exclude businesses that do not operate out of a physical location or do not have customers come into a physical location would exclude a broad range of businesses, and that this simply ran afoul of the meaning and, you know, legislative intent of Title III. Okay. And then to move on to a few cases that specifically deal with websites. So the first one had to do with Netflix. Plaintiffs were hearing impaired, and they sued Netflix regarding the Watch Instantly service, which was, you know, the service where you log on to Netflix and instantly can watch a video, movie, or TV show. And what they alleged was that not all of the movies or TV shows that were available on Netflix had closed captioning or some other way for someone with hearing disabilities to watch them. And the court reasoned that it was irrelevant that this web-based service was not included as a specific example of a place of public accommodation by the statute, and that Congress did not intend to limit the ADA to exclude such services. And this court relied heavily on car parts, which is the case we just discussed. And then the other case, though, is Andrews v. Blick Art Materials. And Blick Art sells art supplies both in store and online. And even though the court observed that some of the online services were independent of goods and services offered in store, meaning that the court looked at the website and saw that, you know, there were goods that were not offered in store, or there were promotions or other things that were good online but not in store. In spite of that independence, the court still ruled that the website was a place of public accommodation.
So thank you, Megan. I'm David Gewurz, shareholder at Baker Donelson. Megan assists me in litigating a variety of these cases in a variety of industries. We're now going to get to the sort of activity that we're seeing occur in demand letters and litigation, and why this area has exploded within the realm that it currently has. The current state of the ADA regarding websites, as Megan mentioned a moment ago, is challenging because on the one hand you have a statute that simply says places of public accommodation without any real application to the dot-com era 28 years later. At the same time, you have case law that is fragmented depending on which part of the country you live in. Typically, then, you would turn to the regulations that would be implemented by a federal agency, in this case, the Department of Justice, that would explain the statute and update them for the current environment. Unfortunately, the regulations with respect to this issue have become something of a political volleyball over the last decade or so. As you'll see in an upcoming slide, successive administrations, successive heads of the civil enforcement action of the Department of Justice have repeatedly put off implementing or even publishing any regulations that might help places of public accommodation decide, A, whether or not they need to comply, and B, what in the world compliance actually looks like with respect to their website. Unfortunately, the only existing standards that are out there date back to 2010, and if you've ever had occasion to look at them, it probably means that you've been sued under the ADA Title III for physical accessibility. But those regulations deal with things like wheelchair ramps, the number of designated disabled parking spaces you have to have within a lot of a certain size, thresholds, restrooms, all of the things that make places that are physical, places that are able to host individuals with disabilities, including those in wheelchairs. Those regulations are utterly silent with respect to how to create and maintain a website that would be in compliance with the ADA. That has not, however, as Megan just mentioned, stopped the courts from fearlessly plowing ahead to ad hoc determine that certain websites are compliant, that certain websites are not, and that certain industries need not be. perhaps the most useful case to refer to in thinking about whether or not and to what extent a website must be compliant is a case out of the Southern District of Florida. So we're talking about Miami, Fort Lauderdale, West Palm Beach area, Gill versus Winn-Dixie Stores. This case came out last year. And in it, Gill, who is a disabled individual, says that when he goes on to Winn-Dixie.com, as contrasted by the physical store, there are all types of services provided to the user. They can access digital coupons. They can look up other store locations. They can use the online pharmacy that they are not able to use because they are not accessible to someone with a vision impairment such as what he had. And there was an acknowledgement in the court case that if Mr. Gill went into the physical store, he would be able to access the pharmacy. There weren't barriers that would prohibit him from being waited on, and that coupons were available physically there, albeit not in Braille and not in a manner that he could use, and that surely there was someone at the store who could help him access store locations. The point that the court, the federal court in the Southern District of Florida, made, however, was that because this gentleman is visually impaired, there are services that are significantly easier for him to use online, if they are provided online, than what he could access in the physical world. So, for example, digital coupons, if the technology exists, which it did, and were made accessible, which it was not, would be far easier for a blind person to access than attempting to discern from a physical coupon whether or not it had expired, what its value was, and what goods or services it accepted. And so the court kind of drew a middle ground and ultimately said, you do not have to have a website at all. But if you have a website, and in particular, if that website meaningfully links back to the physical location, such that it aids your physical location experience, then you have an obligation to make it accessible. Now, it didn't explain or get into the harder question that Megan was raising. What if you only have a virtual existence? What if you are, for all intents and purposes, Amazon, and your warehouses are not accessible to the public? Do you have an obligation to make yourself accessible? But for the bulk of the people in what we understand to be our audience today, and certainly for the bulk of our clients who have been hit with demand letters, that's you. You've got a physical brick and mortar location. You also have a website. And your website may not merely be informational. This is who we are, and this is our contact information. Oftentimes, there are specials in the forms of coupons, discounts. Oftentimes, there are directories. Here's where you need to direct your inquiry. Oftentimes, there are explanations or online forms that are requested of the person who is a customer that they are able to access more quickly and more conveniently at home. And sometimes, as we'll get into in a moment, you are also putting on employment applications or employment information, which also makes your online space significantly link back to your physical location in such a way that at least the Winn-Dixie Court and many courts that have followed in its stead will conclude that you are a place of public accommodation and thus you must be quote-unquote accessible. What does it mean to be accessible is what we devote the remainder of the presentation to. Although what you will note is that most of the disabilities that we deal with in this realm are physical, and specifically they concern visual impairments, hearing impairments, and mobility impairments such that your ability to manipulate a mouse or a keyboard are meaningfully affected. The website accommodation, the website lawsuit accommodation numbers are alarming if you believe in exponential math, because we're starting to get into exponential terms. You'll see that through the first quarter of this year, we were on track to have about 2,500, and that if this were to meaningfully increase and we continue not to have regulations, as is likely to be the case according to most expert observers, we will hit around 5,000 of these lawsuits and then 10,000 before the current administration is up for re-election. How do you make a website accessible? In the absence of a clear overlay by the courts, and in the absence of regulations, and in the absence of meaningful court study on this, there are at a minimum a few elements that most people within the industry can agree constitute accessibility. This is by no means a comprehensive checklist, but it's the sort of thing that would allow you to fairly briskly move through your website as a non-IT, non-expert, and determine whether or not you are likely to have a problem. In order to make your website accessible, captions on videos have to be available. Images and audio files have to have what's called an ALT or alt tag. An alt tag means that there's embedded text within the code so that the text can be read by a screen reader. And these screen readers, as you would imagine, are routinely used as a form of software for people, primarily those who are visually impaired, so that the speech of text, or the text will be orally relayed to them if they're unable to read it themselves. You have to have data tables that have columns and rows that are appropriately headed, easy to read font, colors with good contrast, things that if you have poor eyesight would certainly enable you to more easily move through the fields. But it's harder than that, because in addition, and I'm going to skip this for a moment, in addition to having things that constitute easy to understand accessibility, there is, as you would imagine, a community of coders who are active in the industry called the World Wide Web Consortium, or the W3C if you're in the know. It's an international community. They get dedicated to continually developing the website. So this is not a disability advocacy type organization. And within their large charter of continuing to develop the internet, they several years ago undertook an effort to try to figure out what accessibility would mean to individuals who are disabled. Once again, let me remind you, this is not a for-profit organization. This is not a disability advocacy group. This is an NGO, private, who have gotten together out of interest for the topic and are some of the leading academicians and law professors and coders and people who work otherwise in the industry who got together to put together their version of what web accessibility ought to look like. So what we really have in the breakdown of a typical market of governance, with no statute that speaks to the topic, no regulations that dare be published, and courts all over the place, is the creation of this organization who are increasingly looked to as the quote-unquote gold standard for determining whether or not websites are accessible. And we put at the bottom of this screen their web address because it is not behind a paywall. It is free to visit. And you'll find not only all kinds of academic white papers that perhaps you or your IT professional are interested in, but I'm not as a practitioner. You'll also find checklists and charts, such as the ones that I'm about to relay to you, which help you determine, or your IT professional or web host determine, whether or not your website is currently accessible. Now, as you would imagine, the guidelines that they put out, the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, or WCAG, have undergone a number of permutations, and the most recent version happens to have been published just shy of 3 months ago. It's version 2.1, and that's what we'll be talking about now. By the way, I should note that the WCAG guidelines not only apply to access from a desktop or laptop, they also cover mobile accessibility. And so if your organization is sophisticated enough to have an app or to be able to anticipate that people will be using this increasingly from their smartphones and want to ensure that smartphone access is as accessible as desktop or laptop access, then these guidelines have got you covered. So this is a really small screen, and I apologize for it. And if you can magnify it, it's great. It's only demonstrative, though. The reason that it's so small is because we took a photo of the WCAG 2.1, and it was specifically an example about how you can make text content readable and understood to individuals with disabilities, whether they be auditory, visual, or the ability with their hands to manipulate a keyboard or mouse. And if you're able to blow it up large enough or have young enough eyes to view this, what you'll see is that they have different standards at different levels. In short, they have a level A of accessibility, a level AA, which is a more stringent requirement, and a level AAA. What you'll find is that the plaintiff's bar in the demands that Megan and I routinely receive and review, as well as some courts, are increasingly borrowing not only from the World Wide Web Consortium and not only from their guidelines, but increasingly from their AA standard, meaning that the single A standard, and in this example, what it says is that on the language of the page, you ought to be able to programmatically determine whether or not the web page has a human language on it so that the person knows to apply their reader. A level AA standard, which would be significantly more sophisticated and is again thought by an increasing number of courts to be the gold standard, reviews that the language has to be programmatically determined, and that if there are different technical terms or words or phrases, that they become part of the text that's immediately surrounding it so that those phrases and words can be repeated so that the person who is using a screen reader can be brought up to speed. Now, there are also level AAA, and it's not so much that those are technologically inaccessible, but I think candidly, and this is my phrase, not theirs, it's seen as overkill. The AAA standards under this particular guideline, 3.1, would have you be able to toggle over and find out what every abbreviation means, that if you have lower than a secondary education level, you can have complicated words broken down with respect to their meaning or usage, and that if you have words that are foreign, that you have a way to pronunciate them. You can really trick out a website. And really, that's what the level AAA seems to get to. As you would imagine, the cost to embed those sorts of accommodations can become increasingly more prohibitive depending on the scope and complexity of your website. And so that's how AA has sort of become the standard by everyone but the federal government until recently. As you may know, if you work for either the federal government or you work for an entity that receives substantial federal financial assistance, you not only have to be in compliance with the Americans with Disabilities Act, you also have to be in compliance with something called the Rehabilitation Act, which preceded by several decades the ADA. Section 508 of the Federal Electronic and Information Technology Act of the Federal Rehabilitation Act requires all technology used by these organizations to be accessible to people with disabilities. So if you're with me so far, outside of the scheme of the ADA, but in a quite parallel world, we have the federal government, which requires that recipients of its funds or its own agencies have compliant websites and mobile accessibility in the same way that we're working through in the ADA. These agencies most recently came out with what are referred to as information and communication technology standards. These standards were put out in January of 2017. And in order to be compliant with this part of the federal government, The ICT standards, ushered in by the Rehabilitation Act, if you look at the third bullet, expressly require the use of WCAG Level A and Level AA standards. Now, admittedly, this was 2.0 because this was last year, and 2.1 only came out about 3 months ago. But what we have, in short, is half of your federal government willing to move forward, recognize that there are no regulations, and expressly adopt the WCAG 2.0 AA standards. And the other half of the federal government, at least that with respect to private entities that still have websites and mobile accessibility through apps and whatnot, in a lurch. But because of this existing parallel structure, we increasingly believe that there will be folks who are able to borrow successfully in the plaintiff's bar for prosecution and in the defense bar for the defense from the WCAG 2.1 Level AA standards. And in short, that is your best recipe for success. As I mentioned before, the timeline of coming out with anything other than a private standard is as frustratingly short as this chart suggests. A notice of proposed rulemaking that came out in 2010, followed by no actual rules, a brief blip of life in 2015 saying these regs are coming just around the corner, and recognition of the fact that no, they're not in 2017. So you think you've got it. You've got the WCAG 2.1 AA standards. You're not really sure what that means, but you know that they're published. You're going to go. You're going to get your stakeholders, whether they are in IT, whether they are in business, whether they are in legal, and you're going to have them review them, and you're going to ensure that your content abides by them, and you'll get to it as quickly as your budget and your time and other resources will allow. But it's not that simple. Because if you happen to also be an employer of individuals and you make your website accessible to applicants, and in fact you not only make it accessible to applicants, you require or encourage or even allow applicants to review information or perhaps post for an opening or perhaps complete an application online, well, then the WCAG 2.1 standards may be too low for you with respect to that portion of your website. Why? Because you're now, as Megan alluded to at the beginning of her presentation, no longer just in Title III anymore. You're operating as an employer. We don't care if you're a place of public accommodation. We care if you employ 15 or more individuals. If so, then you have a duty that goes above and beyond what a movie theater or a hockey rink or a library has in order to make sure people can get in the door. You have a standard that requires reasonable accommodations even without the applicant reaching out to you. What does that mean practically? It means, number one, if you've got to go in and examine and revamp your website in order to make it compliant, I would strongly encourage you to begin with the portion of your website that reaches out to applicants and ensure that at a minimum you are at AA standards and that you probably also provide an accessible phone number or other way that applicants can communicate with you if they are having difficulty either understanding or completing your applications online. Additionally, if you have online applications and they are in the store, you probably have a Title I, as opposed to being accessible merely on the web, you probably also have a Title I accommodation that you are going to be called upon, not simply to make the font larger, but you may need to entertain alternative ways for people to apply for a position with you if, for whatever reason, you do not have, and many of you would not, a reader or other interactive devices that would allow them to toggle through the keyboard or use a mouse or otherwise be able to understand the questions that are being asked of them. Those reasonable accommodations are required unless you are able to show what's referred to as an undue burden, which is an extremely stringently high standard. It takes into account the fact that trying to accommodate applicants would be so financially draining on your organization that it could threaten it. And obviously, the larger your organization is, the harder it is for you to make an undue burden argument. Even if you're a mom-and-pop organization who has or allows people to apply online, you're still going to be expected to exhaust all of the nonprofit or free offerings that are available on the web or through other nonprofits before you're able to make an undue burden argument. But that's not all. It's not merely applications for applicants. If you use a website and your website is devoted to current employees, and that is where you provide information about your handbooks, that is how you provide updated information about benefits or other policies, it's how individuals are required to log in, then, and this should probably become familiar to you if you are from an HR background, you have an accommodation to make a keyboard or mouse or reader or other interactive device available to that individual because they are already your employee. One example that raises all of these issues is a recent consent decree that was reached between the Department of Justice and Florida State University, where there was an investigation by Justice into the FSU Police Department's compliance with Title I. And there, the police department had an online application. And in that particular case, they were also, in addition to not being at the cutting edge of accessibility, asking all kinds of questions that have, for over 20 years, been prohibited under the ADA with respect to medical history and family medical history. A consent decree is just a fancy way of saying that this is a court-ordered settlement document. And in that court-ordered settlement document, which is available on the Department of Justice website in case you're interested, the relief that the DOJ insisted on was interesting in that it not only required online applications to be scrubbed of this information, and additionally, there were employee training courses that needed to be made more accessible. But the DOJ took what, in our view, was the unusual step of also requiring that if a person required an accommodation in order to access the online application in the first place, that they needed to be able to ensure that they were compliant with the WCAG 2.0 AA standard. So once again, the DOJ, even though it won't come up with its own regulations, has begun to borrow from this private consortium and specifically their level AA standard as to what constitutes a best practice, to the point where they memorialized it as a mandatory provision of a court settlement. So, what's your exposure, if any? If you get sued or you receive a demand letter, which is more often the case as opposed to getting a cold lawsuit, you will typically end up with a threat under the Americans with Disabilities Act. If, again, you are an organization that receives meaningful federal money or you work for a federal agency, they may borrow from the Rehabilitation Act as well because that already adopts the WCAG 2.0 standards, soon to be 2.1. What are you on the hook for monetarily? Well, under the ADA, the quasi-good news is not much, except for the plaintiff's attorney's fees. And the attorney's fees become the tail that wags the dog with respect to all sorts of demand letters and the exponential increase I was pointing to a few slides back. The only other relief that you are obliged to provide is what's referred to as injunctive relief. You actually have to affirmatively make changes. to, in this case, your website, to make it more accessible. However, many plaintiff's attorneys will sue you from a distant state, a state, for example, like California or Massachusetts or New York, claiming that their client accessed your internet site from this remote state. And the reason that you are hearing from them in one of these three states, or perhaps in Florida, is because that there is also a state law, a state non-discrimination law that prohibits not making places, or in this case, websites, accessible to individuals with disabilities. And under that state law, you could be liable for damages or treble damages or punitive damages, but they will come to you with a fantastic offer to settle with them for the low, low price of fill in the blank. And the market here varies. It depends on the size of your organization. We've defended a number of financial institutions with many billions of dollars behind them and branch offices spread throughout the country, all the way down to an organization that sells beef jerky and is located out of Arkansas and has one shop. But the typical demand tends to run anywhere, at least initially, from $5,000 to $20,000. And these will often be couched as a class action because, of course, if your website is inaccessible to one individual, then it is inaccessible, arguably, to all individuals, at least those who suffer from the same sort of physical disability as the so-called plaintiff. And so they will be asking for this $5,000 to $20,000 either in the form of attorney's fees or in the form of relief under this state law. And they will go on to point out how you are not complying with the WCAG now 2.1 AA standards, and they will point either to court cases that have adopted those standards. They may point to the federal regulations that I referred to. They may point to the consent decree that I just talked about respecting FSU, but they are going to basically hold you accountable to those standards, even though they are not published, they are not official, they are not published as official regulations under the Department of Justice. And one of the arguments you will immediately be tempted to raise, as some prior defendants have, is, hey, there is a violation of our right to due process. If the federal government is going to pass a law like the ADA and it's going to hold me accountable, then the federal government has an obligation under the Constitution to tell me what these standards are. I should not have to send someone to a one-hour webinar in the middle of their lunch break in order to find out what the laws are, and I should not have to guess as to whether it's level AA or AAA. I ought to know, because for the government to hold me accountable to something, it must tell me what I am being accountable to. Unfortunately, that argument has routinely been raised. It has had extremely limited success. The most recent time we're aware of that the claim that that defense has been raised was last week against 1-800-Flowers.com, in which case the court in the state of New York argued that the lack of specific regulations do not excuse noncompliance with the ADA. So once your legal team's ego has been reconciled with the fact that you still have this demand letter and you ask what do? The other challenge is that there is strict liability under the Americans with Disabilities Act. Nobody cares if you intended to violate the law. No one cares if you were about to get around to fixing it. No one cares if you have an indemnification provision that would pass all of the liability onto your web host or developer. The courts will not care. The plaintiffs will not care. The courts will not enforce them. And the plaintiffs will continue to focus on you, especially if you have a retailer presence and a threat of publicity. That threat, by the way, routinely rings hollow. And as a consequence, the best and currently only way to mitigate your risk is to go ahead and adopt as quickly as you are able to these 2.1 AA standards. Ah, but I can hear you saying, 2.1 is surely to be replaced with 2.2, and then 2.3, how will I ever be in complete compliance? And the answer is you're not. Think of it as ERISA. It's a statute that probably all employers violate at some level unintentionally. The point is to make yourself more of a hardened target. And if you can show that perhaps while you have fallen out of compliance in the past year because someone updated the content without checking with legal or without checking with the person who's in charge of this disability program, that 90-something percent of your pages are compliant. It is such a target-rich environment that plaintiff's counsel will almost invariably move on to an organization that is far more out of compliance than yours. Think about having the proverbial Brinks or ADT sticker on your window compared to all of your neighbors who do not. It doesn't necessarily mean that you won't be broken into. It does mean that in a target-rich environment such as that, you are less likely to draw their attention if you have taken those steps. What are the steps that we encourage you to take in addition to those? Among other things, I would take a look at your insurance. And in particular, while you're probably not going to have insurance under your general liability, and you probably won't unless you have a Title I problem with employees under EPLI, take a look and see if you have cyber insurance and take a closer look or ask your broker to take a look at whether or not litigation where you are threatened because your website is out of compliance is covered, albeit without a lot of fanfare or intent, by these sorts of demands. And then you can make a decision as to whether or not your deductible and your coverage is such that you ought to file a claim. But beyond that, there really isn't a lot to do other than be better than your competitors. It's sort of like that story of the two guys who are hunting and they come across a bear, and one turns to the other and says, do you think we can outrun that bear? And the second guy says, I don't have to, I just have to outrun you. If you can take steps that will, compared to your competitors within your field, within your industry, make you more compliant than the rest, then my sense is that if you get a demand letter, you will likely be able to get out of that legal pickle with a minimum of exposure and a minimum of hassle. We've received a couple of questions while we've been waiting. And I want to go ahead and answer those, as well as any other questions that you want to go ahead and send us on the Q&A, which we'll spend the remainder of our time covering. The first question we had received was from a hospital asking, where do hospitals and physician clinics fit in the definition of interstate commerce? And the answer is going to be that it is less about your geographic location and more a question of whether or not you import medication from out of state and then deliver it in state, whether or not you have anyone who is out of state who gets treated by you, whether or not you are publicizing on the internet, which almost automatically is an indicia of operating on an interstate basis. My off-the-cuff answer is that unless you are the smallest of clinics in a fairly rural area and are really dispensing Band-Aids and ointment that you get from the grocery store as opposed to a manufacturer or distributor directly, that you're going to be caught up in the chain of commerce such that you're going to be covered by the ADA. Megan is nodding her head in agreement. The next question that we had were, are requirements like level A and double A success required identically for federal agencies and governments that receive federal monies? And that question, I'm assuming, was posed before we hit that slide. But as a refresher, yes, the standards that were promulgated back in January of 2017 under the Rehabilitation Act for the use of information and communication technology explicitly borrow from those two levels. The next question was a bit longer, and it was, what are a company's duties regarding compliance upgrades if a web browser such as Google Chrome updates and your site is now no longer in compliance? Or if there's a new screen reader software update that's released, is a company required to have a continuous department or a vendor responsible for ongoing compliance? It's a great question. I will tell you the practical answer, but it is not the legal answer. And that is, you ought to have, as part of your internal clearinghouse, where all of your updates to your website, whenever anyone wants to change its content or add to it, that it goes through someone who ensures that that new updated or appendix of a website is compliant. I would worry less about external technology, which I understand is out there and is increasing at a faster rate, than ensuring that once your content goes up and goes live, that that's the time that you are trying to go back to the AA standards and make sure that you're in compliance to the extent you are practically able. For most organizations, that's a refresh of about once every 8 to 12 months, although certainly there are far more dynamic organizations and industries. The next question was from Habitat for Humanity. Megan, what about nonprofits?
Yeah, if you are an employer, you certainly are covered by Title I, and Title III would apply to you, and it would be helpful to go along with the WCAG guidelines.
Yeah, there is no exception for whether or not you earn money or dispense with all your money at the end of the year. And so what your undue burden threshold may be lower if you are an organization that is relative to an Amazon operating on a shoestring budget. But there is no exception. There's no exception for other organizations either, including ones that often receive federal law protections, such as religious organizations or organizations such as that. The final question that we had received was, do these rules also apply to websites for county government, or do they have their own set of rules? Typically, if you are county government, then you are going to be defined under Title II as having your own set of physical standards, and that was beyond the scope of most of our presentation. Title II then will typically cover things like accessibility on your buses, accessibility in your libraries, and it's an open question as to whether or not those locales, to the extent they have a website, are also required to adhere to Title III. I think the betting money is yes, but I'll confess I have not seen a case on that topic at all, and Megan is shaking her head as well. So at least once during every webinar, the experts get stumped, and Shauna from Washington County, you stumped us. That's it for today. Again, the PDF of our presentation that included the most importantly the WCAG web address will be on here, as well as the other slides and our contact information. If you weren't able for technical reasons or because you joined us late to get us a question or to catch all the presentation, be sure to look for that. If you have additional topics that you would like for our firm to cover, whether it concerns the ADA or otherwise, please let us know. And check us out again on social media and our website and on Twitter. We thank you for substituting part of your lunch hour for listening to us, and we look forward to catching up with you again. Thank you.